Hello friends, today we are going to learn about the topic virtualization of input-output devices, why they are being virtualized, what are its uses, what are the benefits and implications of virtualization for input-output devices. Virtualization for input-output devices. Input-output virtualization involves managing the routing or routing of input-output request between virtual devices and the shared physical hardware. Now, what does that mean? See, as we all know, there is a underlying hardware resource also called as physical resource. Then there is a virtualization layer, hypervisor, VMM, whatever we call it. And then this particular thing provides virtual machines which is being used. So now virtualization of input output devices is useful, and why it is done? Because it involves the managing of the routing or routing of input output request, input output request between the virtual devices, that means these virtual devices, and the shared physical resources amongst those devices. At the time of this, there are three ways to implement input-output virtualization. First one, full device emulation. Second one, para-virtualization. And third one, direct input-output virtualization. Full device emulation is the first approach for input-output virtualization. Generally, this approach emulates well-known real-world devices. Now, what is this? That means full device emulation. What it does? It knows the real-world devices which is there existing in the physical resources, or which are there, which needs to be virtualized and which is required in the communication amongst the devices in the virtual machine as well as the physical resources. Now here we have this guest operating system which is in the virtual machine. Then we have this device driver, also known as guest device driver. Then this is the virtual device. Now here device emulation, input output stack, device driver. This all it includes and comprise of a layer which is known as virtualization layer. This virtualization layer does emulates the virtual device, reamps or remaps guest and real input output addresses, multiplexes and drives the physical device, input output features, example cow disk, etc. Then this is the real device. Real, that means the physical resource or the hardware platforms. This may be different from the virtual devices, or the configuration will be different from the virtual machine configurations. Now here, all the functions of a device or bus infrastructure, such as device enumeration, identification interrupts and DMA, that is direct messaging access, are replicated in a software. That means all these bus infrastructure which includes device enumeration, identification, interrupts and DMA will be mirrored or replicated in the software. In which software? Which is providing virtualization. This software is located in virtual machine manager and it acts as the virtual device. The input-output access request of the guest operating system are then trapped in the virtual machine monitor, which interacts with the input-output devices. The full device emulation approach is shown in the figure above. That means which we have seen, which has the guest operating system, which has its virtualization layer and the real device, how they interact, what are the things we have seen there. So that full device emulation, that means that complete device which is present there will be emulated or virtualized for the input output access requests. A single hardware device can be shared by multiple virtual machines that run concurrently is virtualization process. Now, however, software emulation runs much slower than the hardware it emulates. That means this software emulation, software which is present in the virtual machine monitor, it runs much slower as compared to the hardware in which or hardware which emulates that particular software. The para-virtualization method of input-output virtualization is typically used in Zen. Now, here we were talking about virtual machine manager, which is full device emulation. Now, coming to the para-virtualization, it is with the help of this Zen and is typically also used in Zen. It is also known as the split driver model, consisting of a front-end driver and a back-end driver. That means it is splitted or divided into two parts, front-end and the back-end. The front-end driver is running in domain U and the back-end driver is running in domain 0. They interact with each other via a block of shared memory. See, we have this particular memory block. Now it is shared with the two devices. So, now these two, front-end and back-end, they interact with each other. That means front-end memory interact with the back-end memory and back-end memory interact with the front-end memory. Domain U and domain 0, they interact via this particular block of shared memory, which is being shared by both the devices or the domains. The front-end driver manages the input-output request of the guest operating systems, and the back-end driver is responsible for managing the real input-output devices and multiplexing the input-output data of different virtual machines. Although para-input-output virtualization achieves better device performance than full device emulation, it comes with a higher CPU overhead. Direct input-output virtualization lets the virtual machine access devices directly. Now, as we have seen, there are three different categories. First one is the full emulation, second one is the para-virtualization, and third one is the direct input-output virtualization. So, what direct input-output virtualization do here is, it lets virtual machine to access the devices which is real or in the real device which is being virtualized. So, it accesses the devices directly here. It allows it. It can achieve close to native performance without high CPU costs. However, current direct input-output virtualization implementation focuses on networking for the mainframe computers. That means it is not in the scenario at present, but it is there working, networking of the mainframe computers. There are a lot of challenges for commodity hardware devices. For example, when a physical device is reclaimed, that means required by workload migration for later reassignment, it may have been set to an arbitrary state. Example, DMA to some arbitrary memory location, direct memory access to some arbitrary memory location that can function incorrectly or even crash the whole system which is there. Since software-based input-output virtualization requires a very high overhead of device emulation, hardware-assisted input-output virtualization is critical. Intel VTD, now the VTD by Intel, supports remapping of input-output direct memory access, transfers and device-generated interrupts. The architecture of VTD provides the flexibility to support multiple usage models that may run unmodified special purpose or virtualization-aware guest operating systems. Another way to help input-output virtualization is via self-virtualized input-output, also known as SVIO. The key idea of SVIO is to harness the rich resources of the multi-core processor. That means the processor which is being used these days they are multi-core processors, and to use that particular multi-core processor or the processor which is rich in resources to use to its full capability, this SVIO, that is self-virtualized input output, is there or harnessed there. All tasks associated with virtualizing an input output device are encapsulated in SVIO. It provides virtual devices and an associated access API to virtual machines and a management API to the VMM. Now here API stands for application programming interfaces and VMM for virtual machine manager. So here what it says, it provides virtual devices and an associated access application programming interfaces to the virtual machines and a management of application programming interfaces to the virtual machine managers. SVIO defines one virtual interface, VIF, for every kind of virtualized input-output device, such as virtual network interfaces, virtual block devices, disk, virtual camera devices, and others. Now, these virtual block devices, also known as disks. The guest operating system interacts with this, that is virtual interfaces, via virtual interfaces device drivers which are helpful to interact with the devices. Then each VIF, that is virtual interfaces, consists of two message queues. These are one for the outgoing messages to the devices and the other is for incoming messages from the devices. In addition, each VIF has a unique identification, or I could say unique ID, for identifying it in SVIO. The VMware workstation runs as an application. It leverages the input-output device support in guest operating systems, host operating systems, and virtual machine manager to implement input-output virtualization. The application portion, VM app, uses a driver loaded into the host operating system, VM driver, to establish the privileged VMM, that is privileged virtual machine manager, which runs directly on the hardware located there or present there on which VMM is lying. A given physical processor is executed in either the host world or the VMM world, with the VM driver facilitating the transfer of control between the two worlds. This is the example of VMware with which we are explaining the particular input-output device virtualization. So, the VMware workstation employs full device emulation to implement input-output virtualization. Now here, the figure below, it shows the functional blocks used in sending and receiving packets via the emulated virtual NIC. See, here it has network packet send, then network packet receive. How does it work? First, network packet send. Guest operating system, then it sends message to VMM. VMM, now context is switched and it sends to VM driver. Then it returns to virtual machine application or VM app. Then the message is with VM app. Now VM app again calls the system, or system call is generated there, and then the message is to VM net driver. Now with VM net driver here, the message is sent to host Ethernet driver. Then host Ethernet driver will send it to the Ethernet hardware packet launch. Now this is the sending process from network packet, how that network packet is traveled or travels from guest operating system to the hardware, Ethernet hardware here. Now how it is being received? Ethernet hardware, again it delivers the packet to the host Ethernet driver. Now this host Ethernet driver, it gives back to the VM net driver. VM net driver will be giving it to VM app. Here memory copy to VM memory, ask virtual machine manager to raise IRQ, then the application is going to VMM. Now VMM has raised IRQ to guest operating system. Message is with guest operating system now. Again, that message is gone to the VMM, that is virtual machine manager. From there, context is being switched again and it is gone to the VM driver. Then it goes to VM app and packet received. So this is the complete process of input output access or request, how you give the request and how you receive the request, how the packet is being transmitted from one place to the another. The virtual NIC models and AMD LAN's AM79C970A controller. This is the particular model number. The device driver for a LAN's controller in the guest OS initiates packet transmissions by reading and writing a sequence of virtual input output ports. Each read or write switches back to the VM app to emulate the LAN's port accesses. When the last out instruction of the sequence is encountered, the LAN's emulator calls a normal write to VM net driver. The VM net driver then passes the packet onto the network via a host NIC and then the VM app switches back to the virtual machine manager. The switch raises a virtual interrupt to notify the guest device driver that the packet was sent. Packet receives occur in reverse.